every Christian. If you're a Christian, you need to hear this. 2 Timothy chapter 2, let's look at verse number 21. 2 Timothy chapter 2, verse 21. And I want to show you one word here that I'm going to talk about a little while. Look at verse 21. It said, if a man therefore purge himself from these, all that stuff he's been talking about, he shall be a vessel unto honor, sanctified and meet for the master's use, and prepared unto every good work. Now the word I want you to look at is right there after masters. Meet for the master's use. Bible said, if a man will do the right things, that he'll make himself available for the master to use. Now, I want to preach this morning on the subject, the kind of a Christian God will use. Should be our desire to be used of and by God. What do we talk about when we say we want God to use us? Some people don't even know what that means. If you don't know what the meaning is, how in the world are you ever going to know if he's used you or not, or if he will or will he? I want to talk about the Christian that God will use. So if you look in the Bible, you can see what this means. For example, we talked about Moses coming in there. Moses back there in Exodus, he saw the burning bush. He took his rod and threw it down. And then he went in to see Pharaoh, and God used Moses to get his children out of bondage. You understand that? God used Moses. It'd be like if I was going to drive a nail in here, I'd pick up this hammer and I use it. The hammer did it, but I used the hammer to do it. If I had a saw, I was going to saw the corner off this pulpit right here, I used the saw. That's what we want to be, a saw, hammer, a tool in the hand of God that he can use us. Now, I want to talk about God using you. God used Abraham to begin the Jewish nation, the Jewish people. God used Noah to build the ark. And when the flood came, there's all say God used that man, Noah, to build that ark. It wouldn't have been built if Noah hadn't allowed God to use him. God used Deborah. For you ladies, you say, well, does just God use men? Absolutely not. God used Priscilla there in the New Testament. God used Mary, the mother of Jesus, to bring forth God's son into this world. God used Mary Magdalene. And God has used many ladies, and females, women, down through the years, just as he uses men. Do you ever ask yourself a question, has God ever used me? Ask yourself that question sometimes. Do you ever feel like God has used you to witness, to help somebody? I believe he has. Sometimes the devil don't even want you to realize it. Use a mop to mop the floor. Use a broom to sweep. Use a vacuum cleaner to suck up dirt. Use your car to get you where you want to go. The greatest honor any man or woman could have in this life is for God to use them. The greatest honor I've ever felt in my life is when those few occasions when I felt like maybe he used me. There's nothing in the world like that. I'd rather have that than any approval that man could or would ever bestow upon me. Any degree, any honor, any trophy, any award, I'd rather be able to lay down at night and think, God used me. My Lord. There ain't nothing like it. There's no greater honor than God using you. I've heard bad people tell me, they said, Brother Danny, I really felt like the Lord put it on my heart to witness to this woman at work, and she came to church, and see, God used you. I mean, if you ever get a taste of that, if you ever felt like one time God used you, there is nothing like it. Now, I want to talk about this morning. Here's the kind of person God will use. If you say, well, the Lord don't use me, preacher, he's never used me. Here's what you got to do. I want to say, first of all, this morning, the man that God will use, the woman that God will use, must have a surrendered will. In Romans chapter 12 in verse 2, the Bible says, be not conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that you might approve what is that perfect and acceptable will of God. It will surrender His will. Now, ladies and gentlemen, this ain't rocket science. Here's the bottom line. If you want God to use you, you got to surrender your will to Him. You can't be self-willed, self-centered. I'm going to do what I want to do. I don't care what nobody says. God will never use a person like that. You must surrender your will. That means giving up. That means giving in. And that means giving over. It is the opposite of being selfish. Surrendering your will to God. You know what Moses did? You know what the Bible said? You know why God used Moses? The Bible said that Moses, he forsook Egypt and esteemed the reproach of Christ greater than the treasures of Egypt. Moses made a decision one day, and he said, I would rather God use me than to grow up in the house of Pharaoh, have all his riches, have all his inheritance. I choose God rather than this world. There's the way you get God to use you. You want God to use you, young people? It's sad today, the goals of so many people, their goal in life is to go on a trip to a foreign country or something. I'd hate to have a goal that little. I'd hate to have a goal that small. That's all you're going to see something here is going to burn up anyway. I wanted my will to be in His hand. Now, to do that, you got to surrender. They said Leonardo da Vinci, that painted the Last Supper, he worked over 10 years on that painting. I mean, it didn't just pop out. They worked years and years and years. And he said some days he would go all day and forget to eat. That's how consumed he was in that mouth. You say, well, I can't imagine that. I've done it. We've been up here. I remember when we was working in this building. We worked all day one day. I could see it full of people. I could see people getting saved. We forgot to eat. Forgot. Somebody went to Chick-fil-A about 5 o'clock that evening and brought some sandwiches in here. Now, I know some of you people, you hadn't forgot to eat over 15 minutes since you was two months old. But I tell you, sometimes you just get in. I get like that at the youth rally. I mean, you forget everything else. It's just when you say, listen, I want God to fill my bus. I want God to bless my Sunday school class. I want God. And you just get consumed with you. I mean, that's all you think about. I mean, brother, that's the man God will use. You don't have to be a genius. You don't have to have a big education. You don't have to have a lot of talent. But I tell you what you've got to have, a surrendered will. You got to have a surrendered will. Amen? Give in. You know what Noah did? Noah gave up the whole world, and God gave it right back to him and his boys to repopulate the whole thing. You know what Noah did? He surrendered his will. Jonah, after he went to Whale University, gave up and gave in, and God used him. Amen? One man said it like this. He said, if you want to live off a garden, you better live in it. If you want to live off a garden, you got to live in it. Everybody knows people's got real nice gardens. They don't take off on a weekend. They go somewhere. They live. And you see them out there every day pulling weeds, hoeing, messing around with the corn. If you want to live off a garden, you got to live in it. And they, like the little boy in the Gospels, the Lord had him down there one day. They had 5,000 people out there. And they said, what are we going to feed all these people? They said, Lord, there ain't no restaurant in 100 miles of here. And they had this little boy, had 5 little pieces of bread and 2 fishes. You know what that boy did? He gave that to Jesus. He gave that to Jesus. And the Lord took it and blessed it and fed that whole crowd. You know what that boy had? A surrendered will. Listen, you don't have to be a genius, people. You don't have to have a lot of money. You don't have to have, this puts us all on level ground. All you've got to do is surrender your will. Surrender your will. You want God to use you this year at the youth rally? Surrender your will. Never forget, when I first got saved, people have asked me for years, said, Danny, how did you know that, I've had people ask me hundreds of times, how did you know that God called you to preach? How did you become a preacher? Who made you a preacher? How did you get to become a preacher? And all I can tell you is, when I first got saved, I starved for the Bible. and I put my nose in this book. I was 18 years old, and I'm telling you, I read it day and night. And if you knew me back then, you know I'm not a reader. The only reason I read a book was when we absolutely had to, and that's going to make you fail if you didn't, and you'd have to do a book report. I would read part of it, and then I'd skip and get about halfway, and then I'd look over to the end, and I said, I believe I about got it. And I'd try to write a book report on it, it'd be wrong, and everything else. I couldn't be still long enough to read. And when I got saved, I started reading the Bible. And I'd been saved about 3 months, and I'm telling you, I stuck my nose in this thing. I couldn't understand it. I couldn't pronounce the words. I'd look down and I'd say, speaking another language. And I was reading the Bible. And I'm telling you, somebody, I thought an epistle was an apostle's wife. For all I know, I had no idea. I told Job. I said, it's over there in the book of Job. I called Malachi Malachi. I did. It's what it looks like to me. It still looks like it. And I'm telling you, I started reading. And I was working the second shift down here at the old Highlander plant down here in Morgan. I worked second shift running a knitting machine. I worked the third shift for a pretty long time. And then they put me on second. My daddy always said, second shift is the best shift to work to save you money. You spend more money on first and third than you do on second. And that's obviously, you know why. I mean, time you get up, it's time to go to work, time to get home, it's 12 o'clock at night, and you save a lot of money. But I worked second shift, and I'd go down through there like this, and I was putting those hooks on those machines and running that cloth, and you take off, and make like it looked like inside of a T-shirt or something. And we'd pile them things up, and it was so loud you couldn't talk to anybody. And so I would go down through there, and I would see that, and a verse of Scripture would come in my mind. And while I was doing that, another verse of Scripture would come in my mind. And I could see a crowd of people out in front of me. And I mean, I was letting them have it. And I'm telling you, I said, somebody ought to say that. Somebody ought to say that. Somebody ought to say that. And it started bubbling up in me. And finally I started thinking, Lord, is this what you want me to do? And my body was working on that knitting machine, but the whole time I was doing it, I was preaching in my head and in my mind. And it wasn't long until I said, okay. I hit the altar one Sunday morning. I'd been saved 11 months, 1 month less than 1 year. March, I saved April. The next March, I hit the altar that Sunday morning, and I said, God's called me to preach. And I'm telling you, ever since then, it'd be like you know what a bee got to do to get a pound of honey? A bee has to make 56,000 visits to clover heads to get a pound of honey. Each head has 60 flowers. That makes 3 million visits. A bee has to go visit a flower 4,200 times to get a tablespoon of honey. And I'm telling you, lady, you say, well, I just don't see how they can get people to come. I don't see how they can get people to go to church. 4,000 trips to make one teaspoon of honey. And I'm telling you, that's what you got to have. You don't have to be a genius. You don't have to have a lot of talent. But I tell you what you got to have, a surrendered will. You know why some of you people, God never uses you? Because your will isn't surrendered. You're afraid what he, you say, if I surrender, there's no telling what God might ask you. Well, you think he don't know better than you what you need? Absolutely a surrendered will. Number two, I must hurry. I'm going to tell you something else you got to have. You got to have a separated life. Amen. I'm telling you, we're not saved by works. We're not kept saved by works. We're not justified by our works. But I'm telling you, you live right and God will bless you and use you. You live close to God. You live away from this world. Here's what the Bible says. Walk in the Spirit and you won't fulfill the lust of the flesh. You got to give up this world. You can have no power with God or be used by God living in this world. Somebody said one time, they said, I'm right with God now. How do I give up the world? And the preacher said, you don't worry about it. You don't have to give it up. If you get right with God, they'll give you up. Ain't that right? You really get right with God, full of the power of the Holy Ghost and full of the Lord. You don't have to worry about that crowd giving them up. They'll give you up. I mean, it hurts my feelings when I'm in a crowd of people like I was the other day and all the other people talking to each other and they know I'm a preacher and nobody speaks to me. That just happened to me this week. And it was all laughing and cutting up and I was just standing here. I felt like, but you know what? They know whose side I'm on. And that's fine with me. I'm just as soon be identified with him than that crowd anyway. I'm telling you, brother, listen, you walk with God. You don't have to worry about the world. You say, what is the world, preacher? Anything that cools you off spiritually, that pulls your affection away from the Lord Jesus Christ. The devil's everywhere you go. Christians nowadays, can I say something to y'all this morning without making you mad? I hope surely you ain't this bad off. Can I say something to you this morning, people? You don't have to see every movie that comes out of Hollywood. You don't have to know everything that's going on out there in Hollywood. You don't have to see. You say, but the latest is coming out and I've got to see it. No, you don't got to see it. It ain't going to hurt you. Matter of fact, it'll help you. You'd be better off without filling your head full of this world's junk. You don't have to know every low-down country and rock song that comes off the chart. It ain't. You don't have to know that. I don't know who's even popular right now. It ain't hurting me. I'm happier set free from this world than I am all tangled up in it. Amen. Yeah, I mean, if you want God to use you, you don't have to know. There'll be no power with God until you come out from among them and be separate, saith the Lord. You know what old John Wesley said about fight? You don't have to dress every way. You say, well, I want to dress just like they were. They whack them off down here, whack them off up here, or split them up to here. I mean, they'll find some way. Lord, that one girl looked like her brothers held them blue jeans like that, and she jumped off of the house into them things. Only way she could get them on. And then they just sucked it in and let it out when she got in there. I'm telling you, you don't have to look like a street walking prostitute in order to be happy. Ladies and gentlemen, you want God to use you. You want God to use you. You stay away from this world. John Wesley said, don't be the first one in the fashion or the last one out of it. Some of you have to think about that for a while. Don't be the first one in the fashion or the last one out of it. Some of y'all stuck in the 80s. and I don't mean nothing wicked. You know what I'm talking about. But Martin Luther said this. Here's the way you know you're separated. Martin Luther said, if I knew the world would go to pieces tomorrow, I'd still plant my apple tree and pay my debts. He said, if I knew the world was going to blow up tomorrow, I'd still do the very same thing I had planned. Listen, man, if you can say that, you're living right. If you can say, if the Lord come tomorrow, I'm still going to do exactly what I'm going to do today. You're living right, buddy, if you can say that. Not many people can say that. But let me say thirdly, right quickly. Do you want God to use you? Then let me say this. Let me say this morning. You have a righteous life. I've already hit on this, but let's say it again. Titus chapter 2 and verse 12. We are to live soberly, righteously, and godly in this present world. Soberly, righteously, godly. You know many people living soberly nowadays? Soberly. That don't just mean not drunk, although it does include that. But it means sober-minded, sober thinking. Thinking seriously about the thing, not just a goof off all the time. I cannot do great things, but I can do great things in a small way. That's what one man said. I cannot do great things, but I can do small things in a great way. Ladies and gentlemen, it will not hurt you to obey God. You want a clear conscience? Live right. Be faithful to church. Serve God. Keep your conscience clear. Then you can pray better that way. The Lord will bless you. We need like Old Faithful. You ever heard of Old Faithful? The geyser out yonder in, I mentioned it last week, Yellowstone Park or where that thing is. Every 65 minutes that you can set your clock by it, they say. Every 65 minutes, boom, man. Hot boiling water shoots up, they say, 170 feet in the air. Straight up. And people come from everywhere in the world to see the geyser, Old Faithful. Man, could we have a church if we had a bunch of them just just like that. Over. And thank God we do. We got some people sitting in here this morning. I can start naming them off. Buddy, I'm telling you, when them doors is open, they're here and their family's here. I thank God for that. Faithfulness. I mean, you don't have to be smart or educated or good looking or rich or nothing to be faithful. Just be faithful. Just be faithful. Just be faithful. Tell you what I read or heard. That on 9/11, when the World Trade Center got hit, the call and the radios on all the firemen's trucks and emergency equipment, ambulances, and all of New York City went off. So no matter where they was in New York City, they got a message, get over here, get over here. The World Trade Center's been attacked. And as one guy was in his truck and he got the message, the World Trade Center's been hit, and that boy got his equipment and his gear, whatever, weighed 60 pounds. There's so much traffic he couldn't get his truck turned around. And that boy took his gear, 60 pounds, put it on his back, and ran 2 miles to get to the World Trade Center and inside that building to fight that, and died inside the World Trade Center, and he's 35 years old. Run 2 miles with a pack on his back to get into the World Trade Center. Listen, give us a church full of men like that, we could turn this town upside down for the glory of God. Amen? I can't get some of you guys to visit a trailer park for 15 minutes with no weight on your back. You want God to use you? Brother, be sober, righteous, godly in this present world. Give him your money. Give God your tithe. Listen, you ain't even the first base if you can't trust God with your money. One man said, good night, I made a lot of money. One man said, when I made $100 a week, I could give him 10. That wasn't no problem. And then I started making $1,000 a week. Whoo, that's the $100. Yeah, but that's $900 that he lets you keep to spend on you. And he give you the sense to make that money. And he give you, don't you be stingy with that money. Man asked me, one of our men here asked me the other day. They said, preacher, what do you do about your taxes when you get your tax money back? Do you pay your tithes off that? I said, absolutely, of course you do. You know what the Bible teaches? Everything that comes into my hand. Everything that comes into my hand. If somebody sees me over here and says, Danny, I appreciate you giving $100, 10 of that belongs to the Lord. That's right. Now, if you can't get that, you need to get in your book and you need to ask God. But I'll tell you why. Because God's got your future in his hands. You listen to me? When you want God to use you, pay him like you're supposed to. Do what you're supposed to financially and God will. You say, well, I just, gosh, that's a lot of money. Yeah, but you better remember where that 90% is coming from. And he can take the rest of it if he wants to. I've known a lot of Christians had to go to the hospital and have their tithes took out. Hey, amen. They got cirrhosis of the giver. That's what somebody said. You know what I learned? I learned a long time ago, buddy, when God gives me something, give him his part. Give him his part. They ain't never been a church went broke. Ain't never been a person went broke by honoring God and giving him his part. And all God's people said, amen. Hallelujah. I'm glad you agree with that. Amen. Godly. Godly in this present world. Which bothers you the most? A soul dying lost this week or somebody hitting your car in the parking lot and not telling you about who it was? Which bothers you more, missing church service or having to miss a day's work and lose a little money? Which bothers you more, the church not growing or your personal bank account not growing? Which bothers you more, your offering decreasing or your income decreasing? Which bothers you more, your kids missing Sunday school or missing regular school on Monday or Tuesday? A righteous life. A righteous life. Number four, you want God to use you? Some of you done fell off the wagon there about 2 points back. You say, well, I ain't wanting God to use me. Well, he won't. And you're going to waste your life. When you get to heaven, if you go to heaven, you're going to get to heaven and your whole life's going to go up in smoke at the judgment seat of Christ. And you're going to say, why didn't I do more for God? I didn't know I was going to be dead this quick. That's what you're going to say. I didn't know it was going to happen this soon. And listen, you want God to use you? Number four, a sweet temper. A sweet temper. The Bible said, declared us, Colossians 1:8, the Spirit, the love of the Spirit, love in the Spirit, Spirit controlled. Now, if you're married to a grouchy person, anybody in here? No. Married to a grouchy person. Now, if two grouches are married to each other, you really got problems. If you got a grouchy mama, or a grouchy daddy, or a grouchy child, or a grouchy wife, or something, you know what they say in sailing? Listen to this. The more maneuverable ship gives way to the less maneuverable. You understand that? I ain't got time to explain all. It means a great big old ship can't turn as quick as maybe as a little jet ski or something. So whichever one can move to keep from hitting each other needs to move. Some of you need to be the more maneuverable. You're a little smarter, you got better sense, and you can avoid a lot of fights in your home because the other is, dumb. And not realizing what you're fighting about. Most of the stuff you fight about ain't worth fighting about anyway. I guarantee you, say, we had a big fight the other day. I guarantee you, most of the men anyway, couldn't remember what your last fight was about. And it was World War III, brother. Now I don't even remember what is over. Ladies and gentlemen, you got to have a sweet temper. You know, some people, I've heard people say this, I'll tell you one thing, I'll forgive her, but I never want to see her again. I never want to be around her. You ain't forgive them. I don't want nothing else to do with them. I'm marking them off my list. I'm going to ask you one question. Is that the way you want God to do you? You want God to say, I forgive you, but I ain't never having nothing else to do with you again. No, you don't. No, you don't. You say, well, Brother Danny, it's impossible. They're talking about Corrie Ten Boom, and they're putting him in prison, and how she's having a hard time forgiving. You can't do that kind of forgiveness without the Lord's help. It takes supernatural power and the Spirit of God. Ladies and gentlemen, God don't use hateful, irritable, moody, self-centered people. Once again, God don't use hateful, irritable, moody, self-centered people that can't even control their emotions and think the whole world revolves around them and their feelings and what they want to do at that moment. Number five, you want God to use you, you got to have a prayerful spirit. A prayerful spirit. The book of Jude says pray in the spirit. The Bible said pray without ceasing. Prayer is the wire that connects us. Like this microphone is no good without that wire connecting it. And then one back there to that power source back there in the back. That's the only way. This little mic that I've got on my ear right here is as connections that go right to that box back there, and the wires go into the box and the amplifier, and it makes my voice come out those speakers. But if this thing, the battery's dead, there's no connection. That's the way a Christian is. A Christian who's not hooked up, a Christian who's not plugged in to God is useless. Folks, we need to pray. We need to pray. The old time people prayed. The old time men of God prayed. Do you know what wait on the Lord means? You even know what that means? Wait. Have you ever sat in the doctor's office and waited? That's what it means. You ever sat in the hospital room and just the waiting room? I mean, you sit in there sometimes for hours. Here's the way we pray. Lord, I pray you bless the service today. Bless mom and dad. And Lord, bless the preacher and bless the church. Bless all of them in Jesus' name. Amen. And we're off to work like that right there. And that's better than nothing. But you better tell her what you better learn how to do. You want God to use you? Learn how to wait on him. Sometimes the best way to do is get in your closet and just get down there and don't say nothing. Just wait upon the Lord. Listen, we have coming up here in 2 months the greatest opportunity. There'll be more lost, unsaved young people in that meeting over at that fairground of probably any meeting in this part of the country this year. We have an opportunity like very few churches have to reach young people. And I can't do it. Somebody say, oh, Brother Danny, he'll come up with something. I can't do it. I don't have the power to touch somebody else. It takes the Lord. It takes his power. It takes him. I'm just a man just like you. We've got to have his power. And the only way you can have that is learn how to wait upon him. Webster worked on his dictionary 36 years. People say, boy, he must have been a genius. 36 years? I could probably come up one that length of time. David Brainerd prayed himself to death. Pray and Hide had calluses on his knees from praying. I was up here praying last night, and I kneeled down about both of my knees busted up from the ball game that night, and it was bloody, and I kneeled down, and it hurt, and I thought, you know what? Them old men of God like that, they had their knee, they had calluses on their knees and rubbing grooves in the floor where they waited on God. We are living in a microwave Christian generation. We got to have this. Let's go in here. Let's worship. Let's get this over with. I want to go do this. I want to go do that. Brother, you want God to use you. You got to have a prayerful spirit. We need some ladies that will get under the burden for the youth rally and say, listen, if anybody else does or not, I'm on in my prayer closet every day. I'll stay there and I'll beg God and I'll pray the power of God down on our youth rally this year. You want God to use you. Have a prayerful spirit. Every great Christian in history did that. Number six, I'll hurry. You got to have a clear eye. Do you ever, here's your verse of scripture. Explain this verse to me. Matthew 6:22. The light of the body is the eye. Therefore, if thine eye be single, thy whole body is full of light. Explain that verse to me. You say, well, that just means you can see this. No, no, no. That's a verse, buddy. Thy whole body will be full of light. If your eye is single. Now, here's what, let me just comment about that. Don't look around, you'll be discouraged. Don't look within, you'll be disgusted. Don't look back, you'll be defeated. You learn to look up, to trust Him, to put the Lord first. Look unto Jesus, the author and finisher of our faith. This world is desperately wicked. And I know people, all every time I talk to them, they're always, well, Brother Danny, I failed the Lord, and I really messed up. Well, join the crowd. We all have. My pastor always said, many people let the failures of yesterday and the fears of tomorrow rob them of the joy of serving God today. There ain't nothing you can do about yesterday. It's gone. There ain't nothing you can do about tomorrow. It ain't here yet. But I tell you what you can do. You can drop a dollar in an offering plate. You can stand and sing a song. You can shake somebody's hand and say, I'm praying for you. You can read this book. You can get somebody at the youth meeting this evening. You can do something today. Do something today. Do something today. Do something today. I'll never forget reading about General Joseph Reed in his army, and he was offered a bunch of money by the other army to desert. And here's what he said. Gentlemen, I'm a very poor man, but your king ain't rich enough to buy me. And that'll be every Christian in this room's attitude this morning. We ain't much, but the devil ain't got nothing out there that he can buy us with. We ain't for sale. Tell them that, young girls. You say, well, I'm going to live for the Lord, but if he ever asks me out, see, you're for sale. You say, well, I'll live for the Lord, serve God, but if I get this job opportunity, I'm out of here. You're for sale. Hey, let them say, they ain't rich enough to buy us. I'll say one more thing and I'm through. You got to have a holy hunger. A holy hunger. The Bible said, he that hunger and thirsteth after righteousness. Don't feed the flesh. Walk in the Spirit. Somebody better show God to this generation. I'll never forget the revival I got saved in. Every year when it starts getting this time, I start thinking about it. And I'd been to that church several times growing up. I had a buddy of mine in high school, one of the guys I played in band with, when I was about 14, I'd spend a night with him, and we'd go to that church. And every time I went there, I never felt one thing. We'd just go sit and write on the little tithing envelopes and have our head down like that and talking back and forth during the preaching. And I hated Sunday school because back then in them Sunday school class, they'd pass a little quarterly around and everybody had to read. You know, I said, I don't want to read this, man, in front of these people. I felt stupid doing that. And I never felt one thing. But in that year, that revival hit that church. And they said a revival hits like that once every 40 years in a community. And I went that night. An old man, Joe Parson, was sitting up here. He looked like he was about 100. He was probably 60-something years old then. I thought he was 100. And he sat up here, and as a group got up and started singing. And when that group got up and started singing, something happened in that church. The power of God was in there, y'all. The power of God. You know what people in this area, all over the country, don't? They think you just get a beautiful building and get some good singing, and boy, you'll just have a great church. That's okay, but that ain't what a real church. That didn't get me out of my sins. You say, well, they had good music. We had better music. They had a big sound system. We had a sound system. I used to take my little, I had a little bitty MG and had speakers, and we'd set it on top of it, or on the trunk, or had the top down, and play basketball behind Nebo School down there. They built an outside court, and we just stayed down there and played, turn it up just as loud as you could turn it. What I'm saying is, when people come in a church, they've got to get something that they can't get out there. They can get dancing and rock and roll and stuff out there, y'all. They got to find something in here that you can't find out there. And I did. There's something there that night I had never felt. And I got saved. I got saved. I had a hunger for God. You want God to use you? You do them 7 things. Get out of your seat this morning. Get down here and say, God, I'm not much, but the best I can do right now, I'm giving you everything I've got. He ain't going to hurt you. You think he's going to cheat you? You say, man, if I get down there and do everything around me, I know what's next. He'll make me. No. You think he's going to hurt you? Do you honestly think you can figure out your life better than he can? You get it right, he'll bless you for it. Let's stand. That's the kind of person God will use.